Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadja Varney, your host, and we're coming to you from George Mason University in Fairfax, Virginia. In our rapidly changing world, teachers are still the crucial variable for quality education and student achievement. However, policy in education often dictates who may teach, the parameters of their career moves, and even mandates that control curriculum and testing and accountability. Education policy language can actually sometimes work against the very goals that they're trying to achieve. Today, I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Penelope Earley, researcher, author, professor at George Mason University, and the director for the Center for Education Policy here at George Mason University. And I'm excited to welcome somebody who always brings us new insights and great challenges. Welcome, Dr. Penelope Earley.
Thank you.
I'm so excited to see you again.
It's
several
good to
years
see you
ago,
again.
We had a show together. But today I'd like to focus on education policy and how it affects teachers in particular. Mm-hmm. But before we go to the issue, Dr. Earley, would you tell me, how in the world did you get so interested, and you've become so successful? You've worked in Washington, and you've worked on major research projects. How did you get interested in going into education policy research?
It all had to do with an excellent teacher.
Ah.
A high school teacher.
Good.
His name was Bob McCabe, and he taught high school American history and government. And I got the policy bug at that time. I didn't know where it would take me. But that's the cause, teacher.
Isn't that wonderful that we forget how teachers' lives do touch? What is that old saying that only eternity will tell just what a teacher's life has done? Well, first let's clarify the relationship between policy that's made at the national level, state level, and local. That gets confusing. Could you speak about that for a little bit?
Well, traditionally, of course, American education has been run at the local level under the control of states. States delegate to localities how they run their schools. And until the 1950s, all authority for education really was at the state and local level. And then, bit by bit, the federal government took a larger role. The difference, I would say, for education policy at the federal level and the local level is the difference between a hatchet and a scalpel.
Ah!
The federal level can really only do broad things, broad goals. When they try to micromanage, we get into trouble because our schools are so different, our communities are so different. The differences have to be worked out at the local level, and that's some of the problems we're now seeing, I believe, in education, because the dictates from the federal government have become so prescriptive that one size does not fit all communities, and people are unhappy.
And sometimes, am I right in saying sometimes there isn't a very much recourse for teachers?
That's right. Because federal laws carry strong strings, and the strong strings are federal dollars. And so if teachers aren't comfortable complying, they really have no choice because the schools need the federal dollars that come with the mandates.
Mm-hmm. This doesn't sound like it would bring great enthusiasm to teaching for the teachers of today.
I'm not sure that it does.
Mm-hmm. So many constraints. One new policy or innovation in recent years has been this National Board for Professional Teaching Standards, and I believe it's a type of certification.
Yes.
I know there's controversy swirling, first of all, about bringing teachers into the classroom who have not been certified, but now there's this new national certification. So I wonder if you could talk about that, and maybe I'll ask a few more questions, but could you give it a little background about this national certification?
Right. The National Board for Professional Teaching Standards was set up to give teachers the opportunity to earn a more advanced credential, much in the same manner as physicians can earn board certification in an area of specialization. And the feeling was this would do several things. It would create a core of teacher leaders, teachers who would still be in the classroom but would be more senior teachers and more expert in certain fields. The feeling also was once these teachers were in place, they would be able to command higher salaries. And that was part of the thinking behind the board, that teachers deserved more money and this higher certification would give that to them. And also that student learning would be affected by this new group of really excellent teachers.
How important is this National Board for Professional Standards? If a teacher is certified by them, how important is this in getting a job? And moving to another state and applying for a job.
It's an entirely portable credential. So if you receive your National Board certification and you happen to be teaching in Virginia and decide to move to Massachusetts, that credential is recognized there. So it is very helpful for teachers in moving from one place to the other.
Mm-hmm. And is it also an incentive for principals, superintendents to hire these people?
I think it is, because I really think it's a badge of honor. It's a very difficult process to go through. Teachers have to be videotaped. They have to be reviewed by other teachers and have their work critiqued very, very strongly. And not everybody who goes through the process earns the credential.
Oh, interesting.
So it is quite a difficult process, and teachers who do this feel they have actually improved their own practice. By just doing the certification process.
You've had that amount of input from teachers
who
have gone through it. Recently, there's been some controversy around whether being nationally certified makes you a more effective teacher. But of course, that depends on the criteria that you're using. Mm-hmm. Could you speak about some of that information that's come out? It's been somewhat controversial about effective it is.
There was a major study done by a very well-known researcher who looked at gain scores or test scores of students over time and then traced it back and compared by teacher. And this particular researcher found that really there was no significant difference in the gain scores of nationally board certified teachers and teachers who weren't nationally board certified. The problem is that there is more to becoming an educated person than just the test score. And so I would want to know, well, what are these children learning that goes beyond the whatever the score was on the test from these teachers? And we often don't know that right away. We don't know that at the end of the semester or the end of the school year. Mm-hmm. I'm just gave you an example of a teacher who affected my life. And until you asked the question, I hadn't really thought about the fact that many, many, many years ago, a teacher did something to cause me to take my life in a certain direction. Mm-hmm. And I think many nationally board certified teachers are doing that, but that doesn't show up on your test score at the end of the year.
Mm-hmm. In fact, just your mentioning that makes me think about the way we are putting so much of our accountability and our expectations for teachers around the students' test scores. Mm-hmm. Not that we don't, I mean, I have never met a teacher who says, I don't want you to achieve. I don't want you to learn. So do you think this climate that we're in right now has something to do with how does it affect this national certification, this atmosphere of we're measuring everything by the test scores?
I think some teachers may decide they won't want to go through the national board process. For one thing, it's costly and it takes a lot of time. And if they spend that time, that perhaps will be time they won't be doing what we call drill and fill, drilling students so they can perhaps get one more point on on the exam, because the exams become that which is most important.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of sad, isn't it, that teachers feel so constrained now by policies that have been set. I mean, you must have a lot of dreams and nightmares because you are so involved in policy research. This certification, though, that we're talking about, the state certification, actually, it usually identifies the areas in which a teacher can teach.
Yes.
Like I know I had, in my day, when I was certified some years back, was elementary, and then later on, reading specialist K through 12. And so that's where I was supposed to be using my time to teach. And I'm hearing that some teachers who have more than one license endorsement, they could have special ed and elementary school, some of them are removing some of their endorsements. They're eliminating them. And doesn't that reduce their options? Why would they be doing that?
Well, yeah, this is a very interesting phenomena that has actually only been revealed in about the last 3 to 4 years that this is happening, and particularly in the case of special education and elementary. And what you have is a primary area, and it might be special education, and then an endorsement area, and that might be elementary teaching. And a teacher might say, wait a minute, I'm a special ed teacher, but I'm not so sure I want to be accountable for my special ed children's test scores, because of course children with disabilities have to take the same tests for most of them as other children under No Child Left Behind. So that teacher may say, I want to teach elementary, but the principal might say, no, I'm not going to move you because I need a special ed teacher. So the teacher can go to the state and ask to have special education removed from his or her license. Well, and then that person could not legally teach special ed.
Well, what would be the impact of that? I mean, that sounds like it could cause quite a bit of controversy and problems within a school.
Well, it could. Right now, not many teachers do it because in many places it's quite cumbersome. In the state of Virginia, to remove an endorsement, the first thing the teacher has to do is go to the local superintendent and get permission to ask to have the endorsement removed by the state. In Oregon, by comparison, teachers are seen as owning their credential. And so a teacher can go to the state and say, I want special ed or elementary ed or whatever taken off my license. So it varies by state. However, many teachers are feeling that they're losing a sense of autonomy because of all of the, particularly the federal policies that are working their way down to the local level. And this is one way a teacher might be able to try to grab some of that back. Mm-hmm. The teacher might say, I still want to teach, but you can't force me to teach something I don't want to.
By removing that endorsement.
This is a very major step.
Yes, because can it be replaced?
It depends on the state. Depends entirely on the state.
So if this teacher decides she does not want to be moved sometimes, mm-hmm. a principal may need a special ed teacher, and remove her or him from a fourth grade where they're feeling very successful, and say, because you have this license and this endorsement, you must go and teach special ed. This is what could happen.
It could happen. And
I don't see that as great impact on children, students.
Yeah, it's a really difficult issue, and it's difficult for principals, because if you're a principal and I'm a teacher and I have two endorsements, you have some flexibility. You have some degrees of freedom in where you can place me in that school, and I'm taking that away from you because I'm feeling threatened by this general lack of autonomy. So schools just aren't quite the friendly, comfortable, collegial places we like to think they should be.
I was thinking that as you spoke, that we speak so often about the importance of climate, school climate. Mm-hmm. And we're talking today about how policy influences teachers. Well, obviously that rolls on and influences the climate in the school.
It does.
How teachers view themselves as creative, autonomous people or not. Mm-hmm. Well, we're going to take a break now, Dr. Earley, and when we come back, we'll continue, because you have some very interesting ideas that are being published as we speak about recruitment and retention. And Dr. Earley wants to change the world, and I'm glad she does, so stay with us. You want to hear these new ideas. We'll be right back.
If you know a kid with a terminal illness who'd like to take their family on vacation for free, call Give Kids the World. You'll never forget it.
Dr. Earley, in some of your writing, I noticed that you write that teacher recruitment and teacher retention, which are common words in the education world, you seem to think they may not be the most effective. I wonder why.
Well, I don't think they should be used together. You almost never hear teacher recruitment without retention or teacher retention without recruitment. And I think it's a policy issue that just muddles the water, because we're talking about fundamentally different phenomena, not phenomena that are the same. And by always saying recruitment, retention, we assume that policy actions can be done quickly. For example, it's August, a principal needs three teachers, is all upset, and the next thing you know, someone in Congress will be saying, well, what we need to do is have a new loan forgiveness program so more people will go into teaching. Well, that's a fine idea, other than loan forgiveness doesn't really work that well. Nonetheless, it's a fine idea, but it's 6 years out. It's not going to help the principal who needs a teacher by the end of the month.
You're saying that Congress might step in because they hear the need, but it takes, they're not ready to move into where the principal's need is.
It's not, when you say, I need to get a teacher right now, a long-term recruitment plan isn't going to be of any particular effect in that school on that day.
Mm-hmm. Well, how would you change? You say you think they should be looked mm-hmm. at separately. Well, would you like to speak first about recruitment? Or I know you use new terms for some of these ideas.
Well, let's just talk first about the principal who needs a teacher. It's the end of August. School's about to open. Mm-hmm. And a principal needs a teacher. There's not time to go out and prepare a whole new teacher to walk into that classroom and have assurance it will be a good teacher. What that principal needs are lots of flexible tools, such as housing allowances, recruitment bonuses, maybe offering that teacher one or two more planning periods during the first year of teaching. Give the superintendent and the principal the flexibility that they need to close the deal. This is what you want to do. You want to hire someone. If you're in business, you have a series of incentives that you can use. I call this labor policy.
Labor policy.
Labor policy. Mm-hmm. It's nimble. It's targeted to a particular school. What happens in Fairfax is not what would happen in Amherst, Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. It will be different depending on the locality and the needs of the individual schools.
Mm-hmm. So you do see this more as a labor issue the person hiring and the person being recruited.
Or
invited to come.
Right.
That's quite interesting because teachers never think they have any power to ask for anything extra.
Right.
You know, they don't go into their interviews the way young business students do when they come out with their MBAs and they go to see their boss. They really want to know all the perks. But I don't see that. Usually schools offer that opportunity.
There's not much. There's mm-hmm. some flexibility in some school districts. I think they should have lots of flexibility. Mm-hmm. And teachers should know this. And uh-huh. it should put teachers in a much stronger bargaining position. Mm-hmm. If I go to Fairfax County and they say, well, we will offer you this. I go to another county, they'll say, I'll offer you the same thing plus something else. That's going to help me make some decisions about where I want to work. And it isn't just money. Mm-hmm. It's quality of life issues.
Exactly.
Where you will teach, will you get professional development funds and mm-hmm. supports and all kinds of things of that nature. Mm-hmm. That's labor policy.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. And now in terms of retaining or keeping teachers,
yes.
we all know that teachers leave within 3 to 6 years mm-hmm. often. So how would you suggest some changes there?
I see that as investment policy.
Investment.
And
excellent.
Investment policy begins actually at pre-service. Where you recruit, this is where you recruit the teacher, and you begin the preparation, and it carries through once they get into classroom through their professional development. And this is really key, because interesting research has shown that in troubled schools, what tends to happen is senior teachers try to mentor the new teachers when they come in, and the new teachers tend not to stay, and they leave. So the school district offers some kind of professional development for the whole school, but because the new teachers always leave, every year it's the same professional development.
Oh.
And so the senior teachers say, I don't even want to go anymore. Why should I go to that workshop? It's the same one we've done the last 3 years. So what happens is the professional development isn't tailored to the teacher. New teachers who are new to teaching need a certain kind of professional development. Teachers who've transferred from another school district but have experience need a different kind of professional development. And teachers who've been in that school district for a long time may need yet another kind of professional development. But the tendency in schools is to take their professional development dollars and say, okay, y'all come, everybody, same room, same place, you're all getting the same workshop.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, it's not meeting individual needs. So we need to have strategic investment in the lives of these teachers, both through their initial preparation, their selection, getting them into the classroom, and then keeping them there. That's all investment policy.
That's an amazing way to think about it. I mean, the rest of the world out in the business world and capitalism talks about this all the time.
Yes, they do.
Labor policies and investment.
Right.
And yet when it comes to teachers, it's like, well, we might give them something as though, you know, we're being very generous to let them mm-hmm. teach our children. So I think maybe this would, along with the National Board certification, mm-hmm. help teachers to feel somewhat more professional and respected.
I agree.
Have you found that that's the effect of not having these options? That how are teachers feeling now? And I don't know, I'm sure you have read some research mm-hmm. that's coming in on how teachers are feeling with what you've called a lack of autonomy and mandates from the federal mm-hmm. level that hold so much power over the dollars. What are the reactions and responses from the teachers themselves?
Every time I talk to a group of teachers, and recently there were about 100 of them in a group, and I was doing a little policy history for them of how we ended up where we are, going back to the 50s, kind of a little policy history. And when I got to where we are now, I said, I just am curious, do any of you know anyone who is thinking of leaving teaching because of the mandates that have been coming from the federal government? I would say 95% of the hands went up. And people started saying,
so?
I don't know them, it's me. And I see it again and again and again.
And here are people who are actually coming to lectures and taking courses,
yes.
but they are still somewhat demoralized.
They are feeling demoralized and powerless. And so what I sometimes try to do with groups of teachers, I try to talk with them about, well, what are things you can do? You are not powerless. We are all citizens of the United States of America. We are not without power as citizens. And to try to help them think beyond their discomfort at some of the policies that are happening. And there are things teachers can do.
Do you feel, this is just sort of a side issue, which we won't go into too much, but I'm wondering how teachers associations or teachers unions, the organization, mm-hmm. I think that teachers have even lost hope in their associations and in their unions. And I wonder if they will be coming back in some way to bring some sort of a solid voice. I don't know.
I don't know either. Of course, there has been some research done on people joining and the fact that people don't join organizations
yes,
as much, the
in
work
general.
By Putnam.
Mm-hmm.
And so it might be that there is a dissatisfaction with national organizations as well. I'm not so sure. I don't know what the numbers are for the membership of the teacher organizations. But essentially, teachers have to understand that their first level of power is themselves and their communities. Mm-hmm. If a school is not implementing No Child Left Behind in a way that's fair and good for children, those teachers vote for school board members, they vote for state legislators, their mm-hmm. local mm-hmm.
Yes.
officials.
Mm-hmm.
So they have some power there. If they don't like what the federal government's doing, they can vote for or against members of Congress, mm-hmm. and they can have their voice heard. And that's the most important thing, mm-hmm. to be vocal.
In fact, we forget sometimes that I understand that senators and our representatives, when they receive one letter, that represents a lot more people.
Yes.
Because people don't write very often. And teachers should be able to communicate on paper. So maybe that's a way, too, that they can have a say is by
writing
to their
senators. Absolutely. And when members of Congress or any elected officials start to hear from people, more than one or two, but you know, if you start hearing from four or five people, mm-hmm. you really have to step back and say, wait a minute, there's something going on here.
In this whole investment plan that mm-hmm. you talk about, which I think is just great, let's go back to pre-service. You mm-hmm. mentioned that and right along into the classroom and professional development. In pre-service, which I mean by that when students are in college,
yes.
studying to become teachers, preparing to become a teacher, how does this investment, is this going to help them pay their tuition, are you thinking?
It might,
What's the impact on
yes.
people that we want to come on into the profession?
I would say we could even take it into high school because there are programs in some high schools that are beyond future teacher clubs. They're actual courses in learning about teaching that are offered in some high schools. They do this in South Carolina, as a matter of fact, and Virginia's exploring establishing some of these programs as well. They're called teacher cadet programs. And many of the students who go through as teacher cadets then apply for student loans that are given to people who will go into teaching. That's more investment. And that's how, because at that point, you're pretty sure someone is serious about teaching because you've screened them carefully, they've had a little bit of exposure in high school, and then as they move through their collegiate program, they learn what they need to be a teacher, but they're getting some assistance with the expense through a forgivable loan or something of that nature. And so that's, again, a type of investment.
This really is quite interesting. I say I'm looking forward to reading the the articles that you've written pretty soon. Looking ahead, though, do you feel optimistic? I mean, you know, you've heard about the lack of morale and all these horrible situations that people are finding themselves in. Are you optimistic or pessimistic about changing policies so that we can have, you know, a stronger teaching force and a better quality system of education? How do you feel about the future?
I am an unabashed supporter of public education in the United States.
Good.
I believe
yes.
It is the greatest system of education on the planet. I think maybe we're at a point where we need a little bit of mid-course correction on some things. I think the idea of getting data about student performance is important. I'm not so sure the sanctions associated with the data are entirely appropriate, but I am optimistic. I'm optimistic that our teachers, in spite of the frustrations that some of them are feeling right now, are still going to work every day and are doing a good job. I'm convinced that children are getting a great education. I was in a history teacher's classroom yesterday, and I was astounded and amazed at how wonderful and exciting it was. It was just great.
Thank you so much. Believe it or not, our time is gone, Dr. Earley, but I thank you for sharing with us. I hope we'll see you again.
I'd love to be back.
Thank you. And in closing, I'll say, in a world that's now often defined as a global marketplace, where what seems to matter most is that best mousetrap, you know, test and accountability, and the proverbial quest for who's doing the best, who has the best. It seems to me that we have to remind ourselves that we're not just a capitalistic country, but we are a democracy, and that people are essential. Today we've talked about how teachers are so essential, and their rights and their freedom of thought, expression, and yes, some autonomy in the education world is what needs to be protected. Freedom of thought, freedom of expression, which I call school talk.
Join the discussion. Send your comments to schooltalk@bridgew.edu.